It's a little overwhelming, but I beg the mayor to let me do the introductions. Earlier this year, I was at a conference where the person introducing the keynote speaker said, "The internet has ruined the ability to prepare interesting introductions. If you want to know anything about this guy, look it up." And then they sat down. I'm not going to do that. I'm not going that far. It's true that I found basics out about Mr. Cisneros on the internet. He was born in San Antonio, where he still resides. Okay, there's more in between. But there's so much more in between. During his distinguished career, he has been a consistent champion for community building, an outspoken advocate for decent, safe, and affordable housing, and has inspired us all with his lifelong passion for cities. You should know Mr. Cisneros is an Aggie.
What?
Oh, Aggie, I'm sorry. He's a graduate of Texas A&M.
So,
that is. His bachelor's degree. He's also a city planner. City planners in the room? He's one of us. He has a master's degree in urban and regional planning from Texas A&M. He continued his education by earning a second master's degree, okay, with my public administration major, in public administration from the Kennedy School at Harvard. And he finished it up with a doctorate in public administration from George Washington University. He returned to San Antonio after receiving his doctorate, driven by his desire to make his hometown a better place to live. I learned from a video from the San Antonio Library Foundation, he wanted to be a city manager. But in the early 70s, young Latino Americans were not exactly encouraged to pursue this career path. So he taught at UC San Antonio. Lucky them. In 1975, he was elected to his first term to San Antonio City Council, then the youngest councilman in San Antonio. And then, in 1981, he was elected mayor, becoming the first Mexican-American to be elected mayor of San Antonio since 1842. That was 1842. Let's frame it this way. A young man who wanted to be a city manager but was discouraged then became the mayor of the sixth largest city in the United States. He was also one of the youngest and the first Latino mayor of one of America's top 10 largest cities. He served for three terms.
Boom.
That would be drop the mic for most people in the career. Like, wow, look what he did. But there's more. In 1993, he was confirmed as President Bill Clinton's Secretary of Housing and Urban Development, where he put his passion for cities to work and better communities to work on a much different scale. One of his signature programs, Hope 6, taking public housing projects, if you will, and transforming them into neighborhoods of choice, benefited Greensboro. The former Morningside Homes public housing complex is now the Willow Oaks community, thanks to the investment received through this program. After public life, Mr. Cisneros went on to serve as the CEO of Univision and then co-founded CityView in 2003, a development group that focuses on mixed-use infill and workforce housing. Believe it or not, that's just a small sample of what you would find if you Google the name Henry Cisneros. But I'd like to add something very personal. In 1995, I accompanied Mayor Carolyn Allen to the National League of Cities Conference in Phoenix, Arizona. Mayor Allen was on a panel about a league program Greensboro had been a part of. It was kind of a dog of a session. You know, it was the end of the day. It was in a far-off corner of the conference, the convention center. There weren't very many people. Receptions started in the middle of our session. When it was over, one of the other panelists, Kate Granger, then mayor of Fort Worth, Texas, asked us to join her in a meeting she had been invited to that we might find interesting. There, also in another out-of-the-way corner, were about 35 to 40 people getting ready to speak was the HUD secretary. He laid out some changes they were planning at HUD, and after about 20 minutes, he said, "Now I want to hear from you." And he sat down at the desk with a legal pad and began taking notes. I was leaning on the back wall watching all this. I asked one of the staff if he always did that. taking his own notes. They said yes, and that he was writing down who was speaking, and many times he would personally follow up and contact them. That meeting left a lasting impression on me and how I approached my career. There were two big lessons that I took with me. Number one, no matter what level you achieve in the public sector, never forget you are a servant to the people. This man was a member of the President of the United States Cabinet. He has people. He gave him people to do this, yet he was taking his own notes. He led without fanfare, without a press corps. He held a focus group of stakeholders, his fellow mayors, to learn what HUD might be doing that affected them. This was no stunt. The second was, wearing your heart on your sleeve is actually a sign of great strength. I came up in planning in an era of the technocrat. This was very precise. We're supposed to know our technical knowledge. The era of advocacy planning had long been gone. Mr. Cisneros patiently listened to people as they listed the sins of HUD, some genuine feedback about the proposed changes, and even an occasional pot shot from someone from the other party. You knew spending time in that room that he sincerely cared. He wanted to make things better and was committed to the work that it would take. I have seen him speak several times since, and I have always walked away with that same impression. Even though he's no longer technically in public office, he continues to serve San Antonio, this country, and not to exaggerate, but the globe, on several local, national, and international boards and commissions. It is my deep personal and professional honor to ask you to welcome to the stage this public's tireless servant, Henry Cisneros. Creating a planning process for San Antonio that we called Target 90.
Buck Rogers and Too Far Away. And Target 90 was 7 years from that moment. 7 years is not enough time to talk about the really big things that cities need to do, but it's enough time to get things started. And as we know, things like building new freeway issues or something of that nature takes a very long time. So 7 years was sort of a good compromise. It was the best thing I ever did. I tell people it's sometimes better to be lucky than smart, because the after effects of Target 90 still reverberate in San Antonio today. We had 12 task forces, each of which had multiple leadership figures. Everything was tri-party. We had an African-American, a Latino, and a traditional Texan, heading every one of those 12 task forces. It was 500 people in the end, and they came up with 144 recommendations for the city, and last I looked, over about 120 of them have been executed in one form or another. And it was just a powerful process. And I'd say better lucky than smart, because I thought the result would be that the goals would capture people's attention. But what really was the best product of that process was so many people were involved and so many people learned. And years later, a decade later, when it came time to talk about a bond issue or something to support one of those initiatives, there was hundreds of people in the community who were signed on already. Leaders of the community could share that information with others. And it was just really a powerful process. Two mayors since me have put in similar initiatives. One was Julian Castro, who's now running for president. He too was secretary of HUD after being mayor of San Antonio. And he called his SA 2020, and then another mayor had a variation on that theme, San Antonio Tomorrow. But we learned the value of bringing people together, thinking through the issues of the city in a forward-looking way. So congratulations and on giving this serious attention. I am pleased to be part of a series that included Bruce Katz, who was my chief of staff when I was secretary of HUD. And he went on from that to create the Brookings Center on Metropolitan Affairs, which Brookings has been very, very excited that they did with Bruce. It's become the definitive place for Washington thinking about metropolitan and urban affairs. And I'm pleased to say that the inspiration came from within the team that we had at HUD, because we were looking at how do you address poverty in a larger context, the city at large, the metropolitan area at large, link people to jobs that may not be in the core city, but at the airport or at the industrial park. And Bruce began to think in metropolitan terms. He's written several books since then, one called The Metropolitan Revolution, and another one called The New Localism. And so Bruce is a convert. He was working at the Senate in urban affairs on a committee before he came to work for me. But his exposure to what we saw in those 8 years, in those 4 years, gave him the confidence and the standing to go to Brookings and put that together. Great job. I'm very, very proud of him. There were many nights when Bruce chaired a meeting that I had to leave for one reason or another that resulted in the Hope 6 program. Thank you for mentioning that, because it was one of our major initiatives. I can't claim authorship on it, because it had the logic had begun before we arrived. Jack Kemp, my predecessor, had Hope 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, which were initiatives largely geared toward selling public housing to the residents, which didn't work very well. The Congress finally got exasperated and passed Hope 6 against the administration's wishes, but basically said, we have thousands of units, maybe a million or so, that are simply unlivable. And they allocated the money to tear them down and start over. The buildings didn't work. The concept of managing the way they work didn't work. We're talking about Cabrini Green in, Ch- Chicago, Ida B. Wells, Robert Taylor Holmes, all in Chicago, places where I spent the night as a secretary and saw with my own eyes, places like Lexington Homes in Baltimore. When I was I went to Baltimore one day as secretary to work with Jim Rouse of Enterprise on a project. And after we finished, it was maybe 5 o'clock. The mayor was there, Mayor Kurt Smoke. I said, "Mayor, would you mind if we go over to Lexington, because I've been reading about it, and I want to just kind of get a feel for it." Well, we arrived, and the police wouldn't let us in the building, a building we expected mothers to take their children into and live in, but they said, "We can't let the mayor and the HUD secretary in the building. It's too dangerous. We can't vouch for your safety if you turn the corner and there's a drug deal going on." But we expected people to live in those kinds of places. Mm. All of the high-rises in Baltimore are gone now. There were four huge, big projects. Some of them were like 12 buildings each, all down and redone on a different scale. Bruce had an awful lot to do with that. So I'm very proud to be here where Bruce has held the stage. Well, I want to talk to you tonight about three things, and I'll tell you in advance so you can kind of keep track of where I'm headed with this. But the first, and by the way, I am so grateful for this process that you're doing, respectful of it, and so appreciate that introduction. I was actually moved by it, that I just want to talk with you in a colleague-to-colleague kind of way, as opposed to deliver an academic address. So please feel free to raise your hand if you have a point at any point. We'll stop briefly and take the question or let you make your point. But really, I'd like to have a dialogue. And for sure, after I'm finished, I want to conduct a lively discussion. So I'll try to move steadily through my portion of this. Point one, this is a global era of urban growth. And it is clearly true in the United States, which Bruce has called now a metropolitan nation. The cities drive the economic engine of the society. And that comes home to communities like Greensboro. It's part of the context in which we work. There's a kind of a rising tide that we can capture, right, and make work for our community. So that's point number one. Point number two, you see up there that my assignment tonight is talk about the Equitable City that builds on that little book that we did for the Urban Land Institute. When cities are prosperous, they can convert that prosperity into platforms for equity. In other words, one of the functions of a city traditionally has been to serve as a platform for people to advance in life. That's why immigrants come to cities, because in the next generation, their children will have a better life. And the generation after that, there will be professional people. Cities have been the staging areas for that kind of human progression. But not always intentionally. That is to say, it's in the natural function of cities, but when cities do it intentionally, we can make real progress in the society. And we may have to in our cities, because the federal government and the states are not really in the equity business anymore, as they have traditionally been, and we live in the places where this is actually possible with some forethought. And I want to talk to you about that. And then finally, I want to talk about how an equity strategy might be viable in Greensboro, in a place like Greensboro. So those are the three pieces, and I'll, as I say, move in a steady fashion through them. First, cities, globally and in the United States, and this era. This is the first time in the history of mankind, this was announced by social scientists just a couple of years ago, that more people now live in cities than live in rural areas, all over the world, in every continent of the world. China presently has 100 cities over 1 million population. It is estimated that over the course of the next 2 decades, China will grow to 200 cities over 1 million population. Their whole economic engine revolves around urbanization. Africa was the 10, 12 million people as the urbanization process goes forward. And the United States, as I say, is now clearly a metropolitan nation, as Bruce told us in his book. Just in the 100 largest cities, and we have 10,000, but just in the 100 largest are 65% of the population of the United States. And in those cities, 65% of the population generates 75% of the GDP of the country. So these are the engines. This is the places where it's happening. In just 100 cities, 75% of the GDP of the country is produced. Why? Because that's where the ports are, and that's where the airports are, and that's where the great universities are, et cetera. 78% of the creative work and research is and patent work is in the nation's cities. And this is a national phenomenon that is measurable. You can see it. In New York, the city of New York is going from 8 million people to 9 million people. When Amazon made that choice, they were rebuffed in the end, but when they made that choice, it was because the work, the trained workforce is in New York that they needed, and they needed 25,000 workers in that site. Boston presently has 9 new mega projects underway. Pittsburgh, when the where you went to school too, when President Obama wanted to hosted the G20 of the 20 most powerful economic nations in the world, he chose Pittsburgh as the place to take them. Why? Because he wanted to show them the transformation from steel city to this place of biomedicine and small technology companies, etc. Atlanta. Its downtown is growing dramatically for the first time in 50 years. Atlanta is kind of reinventing itself. Miami is the de facto capital of South America. It's an economic hub for all of Latin America. And every one of the nations of Latin America, from Brazil to Chile on the other side, and Central America and the Caribbean, come to Miami for economic transactions, recreation, etc. Nashville is now the third fastest growing city in the country, after Austin, which is number one. Those two music capitals have transformed their popularity into great progress, very impressive. Denver has repopulating its downtown neighborhoods. Seattle is home to huge companies like Amazon. In fact, so fast is their growth that their home prices are going far beyond reach, but growing jobs at an incredible rate, as is San Francisco. Companies like Salesforce there. New Orleans, Los Angeles, the place has been called throughout history as there is no there there, now has a there. And it's a thriving downtown where they built what's called Live Nation, where the Staples Center and the Lakers play, and the Clippers, and hotels, and now an arts district with artist lofts where people live now and what were once factory space. Los Angeles is doing very well. And then there's the cities in my state that we call the Texas Triangle. Dallas, Fort Worth in the north, Houston in the southeast, and Austin and San Antonio, 75 miles apart, in the southwest corner of that triangle. And it's proving to be one of the more powerful urban agglomerations in the entire country. And together, working together, we'll compete on a global scale. So the point that I made is not a figment of my imagination. How can we see what is occurring in this urban renaissance process? Now, why is it happening? Well, I would argue the first and most important thing is that the economy of the cities has changed, and it is now more people-friendly. The economy of the cities, in most cities in America, let's say in 1920s and 1930s, was still manufacturing. And we know, just looking around Greensboro, the kind of manufacturing in textiles, tobacco, and other furniture dominated the economy here. All over America, that was the case. Most cities had 30% of their jobs in manufacturing. When those jobs went offshore or to other places, the cities were left with the residue, which was empty plants, unemployed people. They could move the capital, they could move the jobs, they could move the company profits, but the cities were left with the residue all over America. That was what we call the urban crisis. But it really wasn't an urban crisis, it was a national economic transformation. And when that transformation settled, and we found our sea legs, we found that we had a new economy. It's professional services, professional services, new media, international trade, big medical centers in the cities, big universities in the higher education. Name me a city, and I'll name you the combination of either a university or a medical center that's the largest employer in town. And the truth, and then many other things. Things like city governments that used to be just providers of basic services. That was the role of a city government, sometimes with great political input, basic services. But today are more entrepreneurial with economic development functions, planning functions like the ones that you work in, for example. The cities have become in recent years attractive to important populations. The creative class, as Richard Florida describes it, of young millennials. The boomers who have lived their lives out in the suburbs and now seek the stimulation of downtown urban life. The immigrants who still come to our city and create those same staging opportunities as before. There's the new amenities that exist in our cities to support this new mix of industry. John Naisbitt, when he wrote Megatrends 20 years ago, described one of those megatrends as being where there is high tech, there will be high touch, because people need that connection. And that's actually happening in many American cities. The more we have technology jobs, people want some release, some enjoyment, and all kinds of places to eat, places to relax, public spaces. It's a beautiful thing to see. I'm just in downtown Houston recently. You wouldn't think of Houston, energy capital, as a place where you're going to find little best pocket parks with all kinds of creative things for children to do on new kinds of play equipment than I have ever seen before. Public-private partnerships, another aspect of this day. We're using public authorities in different ways, more creatively. All of these things you recognize because you've seen them here in Greensboro. I looked, for example, at the allocation of sectors of industries that are the biggest employers and most economic impact in Greensboro, and they are first trade and transportation with 73,000 jobs, then professional business with 54,000 jobs. Manufacturing here still has 54,000 jobs in the area. Education is 48,000 jobs. Government is 42,000. Hospitality, another one of those new industries that underpinning our cities, is 37,000 jobs in this area. And financial services is 18,000. So you have in the area the kinds of jobs that are creating this dynamic that I've described. Different kinds of people, good paying jobs, a base to hold under the city, a lot of entrepreneurship, small business development. Those are important dynamics. To add it in your case, our good universities like North Carolina A&T, the largest HBCU university in the country, and the University of North Carolina Greensboro with 20,000 students. Together they've created the Gateway University Research Park, an example of how universities are playing their roles today. And then the other colleges here, like Guilford Technical Community College, very important. That's 15,000 students working on the jobs related to technical careers and preparing for technical work. And Bennett and Elon University School of Law and Greensboro College and Guilford College, not a bad aggregation of higher education. point two. The first point is, the first point I was trying to make was, there's something to work with here. Now I'd like to transition to the issue of, well, how does this work in terms of creating kind of equity? Let me say first that our country has a long history of seeking as ideals social justice and economic equity. Can cities, on the cusp of new opportunities as I've just described, harness their inherent economic dynamics to make life better for the mass of people? Can we pick up people who traditionally have been marginalized in society and create the ways to bring them into the economic process? Can city governments, city leaders, design intentional strategies for equity? Is that possible in our society? We know we have national ideals to advance civil rights, sustain a safety net of economic security, and level the playing field of access to opportunity, and we've done it over the years. The federal role was always the critical role in equity. Social Security, public accommodations laws came out of the civil rights movement, voting rights driven by events that were highlighted for the country right here in Greensboro, fair housing laws, health care reform, labor protections, education from Head Start to Pell Grants, affordable housing. That was the role of the federal government traditionally. When I was HUD Secretary, I felt that we were the protector of last resort. When we found things that were not, where people were not being treated fairly, it was the duty of the federal government to step in. I teamed up as HUD Secretary with the Texas Rangers to go into a place called Vider, Texas, where African Americans were not allowed in public housing, and where there were signs basically that said, stay away. We went in with the Texas Rangers and took over that housing project. That's been the role of the federal government. It has had a sense of national responsibility for equity. But we also know that the federal government today is caught in a gridlock of debt and deficit. I've served on our task force that looks at the trajectory of debt and deficit, and it is higher as a ratio of debt to GDP than at any time in American history, but for a time of war, when you do spend in deficit because you have no alternative. That's the path that we're on. It's unsustainable. And now, worse than just being economically restricted, is the debate in the country over what is the role of government itself. Does government have any role? Is it an appropriate role for government to be involved in equity? So the federal government is not today the positive force that it has been traditionally on equity questions. The states have some resources and some responsibilities in this arena that they where they could play a stronger role. They are responsible in most states for supporting public education and higher education and health care, but few states, although I must admit at times in its history, North Carolina has been one that's been on the forefront of using state resources. Governor Hunt, for example, who was a hero of mine, and of Bill Clinton's as well, for the things he did with education as governor of North Carolina. And there's a few other states, New York and Pennsylvania and Michigan at times, but the states, you would not say on the whole, are advocates, champions of equity. So it falls to our cities where the day-to-day life of just observing how people live calls to our attention the inequities, the economic inequality and inequities in our society. So the reality of a more just society can be generated in our cities, but it must be embedded in the way we regard the very purpose of a city. A city is an organism, a live and functioning entity that can be used to make life better for people. It must be evidenced in a principle of inclusive government, a government that says that's part of So what do we mean by equity? What exactly am I talking about? Well, let me say to the group of planners and public administrators that is here, give you some definitions of or ways to think about equity. The first is equity measured by economic metrics. That means, what is the percentage of poverty? What are the unemployment levels and the differences? What is the income inequality? There is a economic measure called the Gini concentration ratio that tells you the ratios between the top deciles and the lower deciles in inequality. There's measurements of assets and wealth. So we can measure inequality with economic metrics. That's number one. Number two, equity has spatial and geographic dimensions, concentrations of poverty in particular neighborhoods, the intensity of segregation as a barrier, inequity in public investments from neighborhood to neighborhood, access to quality education. These are measures of how you would measure the spatial or geographic. Unfortunately, my hometown, we've worked at this for a long time, and we still measure high on measures of economic segregation. Not as bad as it was in the past, but still neighborhoods that are traditionally African-American or traditionally Latino are more concentrated and poorer, with less ability for people to sort of have mobility and move to other places. Spatial and geographic inequities. Then there is the kind of equity that speaks to the openness of opportunity. What is the ability of people to start at one place in life and work their way up into up the social ladder, if you will? Are the jobs, do the jobs in the community lend themselves to social mobility? Or are the jobs characterized by what economists call a segmented labor market, where you can't rise past a particular point? People start on the high track differently, but you can't start at the bottom and get there. The jobs just don't lend themselves to that. You rise to a point and that's it, in terms of a segmented labor market. Educational options would be limited. And so another definition of equity speaks to openness of opportunity. Another kind of thought about equity would be, what is the climate of inclusion? Not economic per se, but just welcoming, a sense of inclusion into the governing circles, for example, or inclusion into the cultural environment. Again, I see cities all over America where the intentions are good, but people are stratified by the lack of a real flow into the cultural life of the city. And finally, I would say what issue we're going to confront as a nation very soon is equity across generations. With the silver tsunami, the aging tsunami that's about to be upon us, and only one out of four persons over 65 has enough money to live out the expected lifespan with the savings that they have. Today, we expect a growth of the over 65-year population over the next 10 years or so to double. Persons over 65 will double. And persons over 85 will triple. Perfectly understandable when I give you the numbers. Between 1946, end of World War II, and 64, the baby boomers were born. That's an 18-year span. 78 million people were born, right? Now, in 2011, the first of the baby boomers, the ones born in 1946, turned 65. Every year, about 2 million people turn 65. So we are right in the middle of that period when people are turning 65, who were the whole baby boomer generation. And as they get to the upper end, toward 85, they will triple the population of 85-year-olds, many of them without the resources, without the health insurance. We have a major, trust me, a major issue before the country. And cities that are fair are going to be thinking about how do we create equity across generations. So those are my definitions of the kind of things you would measure, the kinds of things you would look at if you characterized by social and economic equity would have open pathways to opportunity, no matter a person's origins. Residents could reasonably hope to rise from the most poverty-stricken neighborhoods, from the penniless frustration of the immigrant, to a quality education, and to the economic and reputational rewards of hard work. People could strive and sacrifice in the knowledge that rewards are fairly allocated for focused work, if not in the immediate generation, then for children and loved ones in the subsequent generation. In an equitable city, these rewards would be apportioned not by inheritance or elitism, not through legacies of segregation or favoritism or unfair advantage. Cities can be the building blocks of the society that Dr. King prayed for when he dreamed that people would be judged not on the color of their skin, but on the content of their character. It would be an urban society in which higher education was accessible, jobs were expanding and characterized by career tracks to advancement. Access to decent housing was fair and non-discriminatory. Capital was accessible to striving entrepreneurs in disinvested neighborhoods. And public decision-making was inclusive, open, and intentionally equity-driven. Such a city would reap the benefits of its quest for equity in productivity, ambition, talents, and creativity unleashed. End quote. Just the picture of what a city that had focused on equity and really, really opened up the doors, really unleashed all that natural human ambition and talent, recognizing that these are not guaranteed, but there's people who work and have a reasonable chance that their work will allow them to rise and they will be rewarded for it. So, are cities doing this today? Well, they are. They absolutely are. And I'm going to give you some examples real quick. There are a lot of different functions that we look at in how a city works. We look at cities as places where people live, places where people learn, places where people recreate, places where people govern themselves. And we're seeing the result of equity measures in all of those ways. I'll give you an example. People live. Atlanta has a public housing strategy that resulted in being the first city in America to eliminate all its old public housing. It doesn't exist anymore. And every one of their redevelopments was redone. Renee Glover won the Kennedy Award for courage. But she just stayed with it and stayed with it and replaced all of the high-rise public housing. It's unbelievable when you see a place like East, Eastwood, where they, near the golf course. East Lake. Unbelievable. And another one called Centennial, which used to be, what was the name of it before? In any event, Centennial is across the street from Georgia Tech. And you would think it was college apartments, not public housing anymore. Took down the old concentrations and created what's called defensible space, where people look like they live in private settings, where they feel like they're at home, not having to go up a dangerous high rise, located a charter school for children right in the middle of the project. It's a gorgeous development. Atlanta, example. Boston has a village-to-village network for seniors, where seniors are accorded the opportunity to team up together for all kinds of trips to the doctor, trips to the store, using the internet to do it. Very sophisticated way to provide a support system where they live for seniors who want to live in place. Big issue coming for the country. Seniors wanting to stay in their homes, not be forced to go to a nursing home as they get older. Oakland linking affordable housing and public transit. The famous Fruitvale project where the BART system comes right into housing development. So people who can live right close by and then be in work. So what are some examples of cities that are consciously pursuing equity in the workplace? Well, Boston has something they call the Back Streets Business Strategy. Yes, Boston is a high-tech and glamorous place, but the back streets aren't so glamorous. They're pedestrian little businesses, but there the city has chosen to help the entrepreneurs take their business to the next level. They call it the Back Streets Strategy. Cleveland has lost a lot of industry, but they have the Cleveland Clinic. It's like the Mayo Clinic, one of the more dynamic medical centers in the country. So their strategy, their economic development strategy is create businesses that support biomedicine. And they have the country's most dynamic, most aggressive medical devices small business strategy because they're playing on their strengths. You got to play with what you've got, with what the cards that have been dealt you, with the new reality, and build aggressively on that. San Francisco has a program they call Bank on San Francisco. And what it is the treasurer's office setting up offices to help people with earned income tax credit and other strategies for improving their net worth. Saving strategy. Bank on San Francisco by banking on the middle class and lower middle class and poor people in San Francisco and their strategies. If you go to Philadelphia, the whole west side of Philadelphia looks completely different than it did 10 years ago because they engaged the University of Pennsylvania, the Medical Center, Children's Hospital, and others as job producers, contract vendors, et cetera, for West Philadelphia. In Houston, which may be the most diverse city in America, it's an immigrant strategy of helping immigrants from all around the world. Houston has numbers of immigrant groups for whom the presence in Houston is the largest population in that country after the largest city in Nigeria, for example, in Guatemala, they're in Houston. And so immigrant strategies have proven to be important there. In the area of learning, I said we're going through kind of different city functions and applying them to equity. In the area of learning, Denver passed a bond issue that says, if you go to a Denver high school and you accomplish, you get a B average and you attend 95% of the time, you will have the money to go to college. If you perform in the city's public schools, B average, your way to college is paid for because not the state, but the city government passed a bond issue, a municipal bond issue. We did the same thing in San Antonio with private capital. We said to the young people at first, the six poorest high schools in town, that was on my watch, we started at the San Antonio Education Partnership. It's now 36 schools. We went to the business community and we said, we want to make that promise. Will you help us raise the money? They did, and then we matched it with city money. And that I haven't been mayor for 30 plus years, and that program has been growing steadily. Guaranteed, you're going to college. Money will not be an obstacle if you graduate from one of our city schools. And I'm very proud to say, my successor, who I mentioned earlier, Julian Castro, on his watch, passed a 1/8 cent sales tax. This is a city government now, not a school. 1/8 cent sales tax to create pre-K education. We have four campuses in San Antonio. That if you drive past them, they look like a community college. Only when you go inside, the students are 4 years old. But four campuses for pre-K education that the city runs. You think, you know, people would say, well, that's not the business of the city. Why are you getting into that business? Because when you have 15 school districts in the city, there is no leadership and you have a patchwork. So the city took the leadership and the bond issue passed overwhelmingly. In fact, it's going to be on the 2020 ballot in November for re-extension because it's 5 years into the program. So cities are doing these equity kinds of things. They're doing it in the recreation area as well. Networks of arts education in Newark, New Jersey, for example. Big emphasis at the New Jersey Performing Arts Center. And they're doing it in, as I say, in many, many ways. Individual cities